Hello, everyone. I've got the pleasure of speaking to Prajnanandi once again. We're both enjoying these conversations very much. Hello, Prajnanandi.
Hello, Ratnaguna. It's good to see you again.
Thank you.
I am enjoying these conversations. They're great.
Yes, yeah. I'm sure we'll probably do them just for the sake of the pleasure that we experience.
Yeah.
Now, I want to start by going back to the chapter of the book that you've written. The book is called Autism and Buddhism, and it's, I think, 15 chapters, each chapter written by someone who's autistic and who is a Buddhist. Very, very well worth reading. But yours is chapter 12, and you've called it Joining a Sangha, or Joining a Spiritual Community. And then the subtitle is Finding a Way to Friendship. So I'd like to go into that a bit more. We did go into it somewhat in the first interview, but I'd like to go into a bit more, and especially how it is for someone who's autistic to be going through the process of ordination, the training towards ordination. So let's just begin with simple conversations. How is it for someone who's autistic to have like a simple conversation? They come to the Buddhist Center and someone speaks to them. How is that for you, let's say?
For me, originally, it was incredibly difficult because I wonder, if you're going up to someone and starting a conversation, what do you do, Ratnaguna?
Oh, that's a question for me, is it? What do I do?
Yes.
Okay. Now, I knew you were going to ask me that. And just this morning, I was thinking, what do I do? I wasn't quite sure because I've never observed myself doing it. You know, I'm just in the moment. But thinking about it, there are two kinds of people that I come across. People at the Buddhist Center, for instance, and then people out there in the world. And at the Buddhist Center, it's a slightly odd situation because I've got a case around my neck. Everyone knows I'm a member of the Triratna Buddhist Order. And that brings with it a certain amount of expectation on their part. Probably wrong expectations in my case. So I speak to them, and the first thing I do is ask them their name. Seems like a good way to start, and I get their name, forget it immediately usually. But then we're in, you know, and then I say, where have you come from? And they say, Bolton maybe. I say, well, that's quite a long way to get here. Yeah, how'd you get here by bus? And we have those kind of conversations, and it kind of flows with most people. Then there's people I meet out here in the world, as I said. Like, I live in a block of flats with 152 flats and two lifts. So I often get in the lift and someone's in it, or vice versa, someone gets into the lift with me. And it feels so odd just to stand there, you know, without speaking to someone in a very confined space. So I never ask their names, but I say, oh, have you just moved in here? If I don't recognize them, do you just moved in here? And they often say, no, I moved 5 years ago. And then I say, oh, how come we've never seen each other? By which time the lift has got to where it's going, and then we might walk across the garden and say a bit more. So that's more or less what I do. I don't know if that's what you wanted or a bit more.
Yeah, I mean, that's really helpful because that's what I would call small talk. And it's the way I think neurotypical people start a relationship, which is by talking about things that are not terribly personal, but actually allow some sort of connection to be established. And it's one of the things that neurodiverse people often struggle with, not just autistic people, but neurodiverse people in general often struggle with. Quite often, small talk is very difficult for us. We simply don't know what to say or how much to say, or whether to follow something up. And it's very difficult. I wouldn't think about the sort of questions you were all instantly into.
Yeah.
I would sort of say, hello. I would say, hello, it's good to see you. I don't think I know your name. But then they ask me my name. And that immediately gets it into a difficulty because I've got a case around my neck too. And my name is long and unfamiliar. And then you can see people didn't get it. And that immediately sets up with me a little slight, now what do I do? Do I go into the, okay, you don't need to remember it, or do I just assume that, okay, this will come later? So it's already slightly difficult.
Yeah.
And then where do we go from there? If someone's come in, they're probably slightly nervous. If it's their first time there, they're not sure what to expect. I don't want to be pouncing on them. I don't want to be sort of going up to them and saying, isn't it absolutely wonderful you're here and how marvellous, et cetera, et cetera. But I'm not quite sure what to do. I'm not quite sure where to go with that conversation then. And as I say, I'm not the only person who has that problem. Most neurodiverse people do. So the very first interaction probably doesn't go very smoothly. So I'm wondering if that is what you were sort of asking about, yeah?
Yes. I don't know if you've read the novel, The Story of the Dog in the Nighttime.
I haven't.
It's from the point of view of an autistic boy, and there's a dead dog in his back garden, and he decides he wants to try and figure out what's happened. And part of his journey, as it were, is he goes to the next door neighbors and knocks on the door. Now, he would never do that usually, but the next door neighbor answers, and he knows that neurotypical people engage in small talk. So he tells her some really crazy things about himself, thinking they're small talk, because he knows that that's what he's supposed to do, but he's unable to really do it. So is that how it is for you? It's like, you know that people like me get into small talk and you don't know how to play the game?
Yes, absolutely. The way I have learned to survive this, actually, is by learning a few opening questions.
Ah.
I do it by rote.
Yes.
And hope that the other person is going to be able to run with it. Because if they can't, if they don't respond to me, I can't then take the conversation deeper. It's very difficult for me with somebody that I don't know.
Mm.
Is that different when you speak for the first time to an autistic person?
Absolutely. We don't do small talk.
Uh-huh.
So
how would that go between the two of you? You met the person for the first time. There's someone
we
like
say
our
hello,
buddies.
And then we're going to talk about what we want to talk about.
How is that different from small talk, though?
Because small talk is not probably what I want to talk about.
Uh-huh.
When I'm having a conversation with people, it's what I have learned other people need me to do.
Yes.
In order for us to get to the point.
Yes.
Where we can actually talk about what we were wanting to talk about.
Yes. I know an autistic person who doesn't really like meeting up with people for a coffee because it's of no real interest. But what she likes doing is to have a task with someone. If she has a task with another person, she's perfectly okay. Even if that task is going for a walk, but sitting opposite someone you wrote about this in your chapter that I mentioned, you sit down and you've arranged to meet someone, you sit down there, and then what do you do after that? She finds that very difficult.
Yes, it's much easier if I know why we're meeting.
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes.
But quite often with a conversation, you're meeting because you're meeting.
Mm-hmm.
And it's, in a sense, building a relationship.
Mm.
But that doesn't have a specific task to do or a specific purpose for doing it.
Mm.
It's much easier for me if I know that I'm going to talk to somebody about something specific, as I'm talking to you now. We are talking about something specific.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. So how would it be if, an autistic person wants to become a mitra and they want to get involved and so on, but they're finding the interaction with everyone else very difficult. And then somebody says, should we go for a coffee? And that autistic person is thinking, oh, no, I don't know what to do with this. How would it be is it possible, do you think, that an autistic person would say, let's say an audience member is interested in an autistic person who's a mitra and they want to get to know them a bit and they say, should we go for a coffee? Could the autistic person say, yes, but I don't do small talk. Can we talk about the Dharma when we meet?
I think that would be very good. I never had the courage to do it.
Takes courage, does it, to do that?
It takes a lot of courage to do that. Remember that friendship is a very difficult thing for a lot of neurodiverse people. Yeah? We have had a whole lifetime of not being able to do this. I never quite got to the point where I could say, actually, I do want to meet you, but I don't want to do this small talk. Yeah, in the end, I learned to what we call mask. As I say, I learned a few opening questions that I hoped would actually get me around this. I can only speak for myself here. Other people, other autistic people might find that a very useful and helpful opening. Yeah. But it does also depend on the response of the other person, doesn't it?
Yes. Yes, it does. It does, yeah. There's someone, another autistic person at our center, when she's introduced to someone for the first time, she says, "Hi, I'm her name. I'm autistic." She just says that outright.
Yes, I have started to do that as well quite
often.
Have
you? Uh-huh.
In a lot of situations, it just stops a lot of the misconceptions that people... It's very interesting. There's quite a bit of research that says a neurotypical person can spot that somebody isn't neurotypical in less than 1 second. Yes.
Uh-huh.
And then that produces a slight awkwardness.
Yes.
In the way that the interaction between the two people is going. If I simply start by saying, "Hello, I'm autistic," if it's appropriate to do so, then I wouldn't do that if I was greeting someone coming into the centre for the first time.
Yeah.
You know, I wouldn't feel that was an appropriate thing to do.
Yes.
But I would if I was going to chat to somebody. Yeah. It just smooths the way a little bit.
Oh, that's interesting. Because I guess most people don't really know what autism is. So if you said to someone, "I'm autistic," they might think, well.
Yes, absolutely. There are a lot of myths around autism that aren't actually true. For example, that we don't have emotions, or that we don't do empathy, or that we don't want friendships.
Yes, I want to talk to you about empathy, because I was under the impression until fairly recently that autists don't have empathy. And I mentioned it to an autistic friend of mine. He said, "Yes, we do. That's rubbish. That's rubbish." But then you and I have both watched a video of a professor. And I don't know if he's definitely Buddhist, and he might be an autistic Buddhist too, but he talked about double empathy. Have you ever come across that?
Yes, I have. It's the fact that we don't connect somehow. Autistic people and neurotypical people don't connect, but the neurotypical person thinks that this is because of the way that the autistic person is behaving without realizing that it's actually a two-way thing.
Uh-huh.
Neurotypical people behave differently towards autistic people than they do towards people who are neurotypical.
Yes. What's the difference?
I find it difficult to answer that question, actually.
Okay.
I was going to say something, but I'm not sure. I think it's to do with the fact that there is a slight discomfort right from the start in the relationship.
Yeah, that would be a good way to talk about it, I think, a slight discomfort. But in this talk that this autistic Buddhist professor, I think he's both of those, he talked about double empathy being that autistic people can empathize with autistic people, but not so much with neurotypical, and the vice versa. Neurotypical people can easily, all other things considered, empathize with neurotypical people, but they find it hard to empathize with autistic people. Is that true, do you think?
I think it depends on how well you know the person. Yeah? I would say that people who I know well, I can now probably read better than I could originally. And therefore, there is less of a difficulty with this. And it works both ways. They can read me better than they could when we first started talking.
Yes.
So again, if I'm not making the appropriate response, the automatic thought isn't, "Oh, Prajnanandi has no empathy." it's more likely to be, ah, Prajnanandi misunderstood what I was saying or couldn't actually find the words.
Mm.
Which is a different thing, I think.
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Let's talk a bit more about your experience of going through the ordination training, let's call it, rather than the process.
I'd rather like to do something else before we get there, actually, Ratnaguna.
Oh, would you? Okay.
Can we talk about eye contact, please?
Oh, yes. Yes. I believe that's very difficult for autistic people.
Yes, it is. It is very difficult.
No.
There is something about eye contact which is difficult for us. No. And it's very difficult to explain what it is. I know some autistic people who actually shut their eyes when they're talking to other people because they can't both look at people and hold a conversation with them.
No. No.
I know other autistic people who don't quite shut their eyes, but they look away.
Ah.
And if the neurotypical person sees that as the autistic person either not being interested or being shifty in some way, then that makes it very difficult.
Mm-hmm.
How many times were we told as children, you need to look at me when you're talking to me?
Yes, yes.
Yes. Mm. It is very difficult for us. I tend to overlook at people. I don't know when to look away in the way that a neurotypical person would do. And that can come across as too much intensity and an intrusion. So
intrusion.
It's a very, very difficult thing.
That's very interesting, the idea of intrusion. How do autistic people get on with WhatsApp?
WhatsApp is, if it's texting, it's fine.
Uh-huh. What about being in a WhatsApp group?
A WhatsApp group, as with neurotypical people, it depends on the autistic person. Sometimes there's just too much input.
Yes.
And an autistic person can't actually do that, even with other autistic people.
Yes.
Or neurodiverse people.
Yes.
Usually, it's easier because we all have a similar background.
Mm.
We all know that there are going to be difficulties with communication and friendship.
Mm.
And therefore, we tend to have a little more tolerance, perhaps, for that.
Yes. The reason I mentioned this is because, again, an autistic person I know has come out of nearly all WhatsApp groups. Because, you know, somebody writes a little text, I can't be there tonight, and somebody writes back and says, oh, well, I'll be sorry not to see you, and then three or four more people. And she feels this is an intrusion into her life. So she just drops all WhatsApp groups.
Yeah. We all have different levels of comfort with the amount of input.
Mm.
For many autistic people, and for many neurodiverse people in general, those levels of comfort are different than the ones that are usually experienced by neurotypical people.
Mm.
We may either need a lot less communication or a lot more communication. It just depends on whether we're hyper or hyposensitive.
Yes.
So if you need a lot less communication, you probably aren't going to be contributing to a WhatsApp group. You may not want to meet up with somebody very regularly.
Well, yes.
You just may not be able to do that.
Yes.
And again, if that is taken as being not interested in friendship, then that causes a difficulty, shall we say, within the relationship.
Yes, yes. So two things coming from that. One is, again, the ordination training, which relies a lot on personal contact. We'll come back to that in a moment. The other thing I wanted to ask you, and this is a difficult question, which is, let's say you are an order member at a Buddhist center and there's someone coming along, they become a mitra and so on, and you think they may be autistic. Should you suggest that to them or not?
Ugh. That is so difficult.
Mm.
That really is a difficult question to answer. The person may not know that they're autistic or neurodiverse. there is a lot of stigma associated still in society with saying I am autistic.
Yeah.
It happened to me before I knew I was autistic.
Did it?
That somebody came up to me and said, so what sort of autism do you have then?
Gosh.
And that was on a retreat. That was on an ordination training retreat. And I had absolutely nowhere to go with that because at that time I didn't know I was autistic. Mm. And I'm sitting there thinking, what is this person on?
Yeah.
What is going on for this person that they think it's okay for them to say to me, oh, by the way, what sort of autism do you have then? Yes. Yeah. And yet at the same time, if there are real problems with communication and friendship, how are we going to approach this? I wouldn't ask somebody, are you autistic? If I knew somebody well, I might wonder whether they were perhaps neurodiverse and get over sensory overload or something. I might ask that.
Yes.
It's slightly less of a jolt to be asked, are you neurodiverse, than it is to be asked, are you autistic? It could be very painful, actually. Particularly if you have then no way of answering the question.
Yes. It's difficult, isn't it? Because as people are becoming more aware of autism, and hopefully all the members of Buddhist centres are becoming more aware of it, you might think, oh, that person might be autistic. And it would be good if they knew that, because people I know who've had the diagnosis, as it's called, seem to thrive better because they understand more what's been going on all their life with other people. And also in the ordination process, which we're going to come on to in a moment, so much is expected of the ordinee, I think that's the right word, the ordinand, who wants to get ordained. They feel very strongly that they are effectively going for refuge and they want to join the order. But they're kind of held up by partly the way they communicate is different. So people, neurotypical people, usually think that's their problem kind of thing. But also some of the things that are asked of you, like having a network of friendships, for instance, is that doesn't sound at all attractive to autistic people, does it?
It's not even that it's not attractive. It's not possible.
Huh.
To have a network of friendships, to build that, if every single conversation is difficult, it's not possible unless you see people very, very regularly.
Well,
and there are things, for example, you know, there's a suggestion that you need to be building meaningful relationships with order members outside your center.
Well,
I found that almost impossible to do. I still do find that almost impossible to do.
Yeah.
Although I've obviously got more opportunities now I'm in the order. Cool. But I cannot do that unless I'm seeing somebody probably several times a week.
Cool.
And that really restricts what you're able to do in terms of building networks of friendships.
Yes. So did you join the order not having built up a network of friendships?
I had two close friends.
That's not a network. That's close friends.
I had quite a few people that I knew, because after all, I'd been around Triratna for a long time. Ooh. There were people that I was building relationships with. I don't think I thought of that as a network.
Ooh.
Everybody I was building a relationship with was somebody that I saw regularly.
Yes.
Maybe that is a network. I'm not sure.
Yeah, it's because I understand why that's one of the six guidelines, or part of one of the six guidelines in the ordination process. You need to build up a network of friendships. Importantly, some people outside of your local area too. So what can an autistic person do who simply can't do that? You know, they can't even think about doing that. It's too hard. And I can understand why they ask that. The ordination teams, for instance, ask that because people have got to get to know you and to see whether you're ready for ordination to begin with. but also that you're joining an order, and that doesn't mean you're just joining a network of three or four people. I can understand that. But on the other hand, it's a very big ask, perhaps the impossible ask for an autistic person.
Yeah, it's a very complicated area, isn't it? I really understand that the order actually exists as relationships between people. Well, I get that. That's what the order is. What I find difficult is that people think that must always look like you have a lot of people that you know. I think someone has to show the capacity for friendship. And that might mean making a good friendship with one or two people, but they may not have the capacity to do more than that. And if you're saying that you can't be ordained unless you can do more than that, then I have a question about that. I do question that.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
So, as there are quite a few autistic people in our movement, and some of them are order members, and the ordination process is, I mean, it's a difficult thing to ask of the ordination teams because they're already so busy and they've only got so many resources, but could there be a different route to ordination, a recognised route for autistic people, do you think?
I think that it is hugely complex to go down that route, because actually everybody is different. And I think that there may be some way of saying, actually, we can see that this person is not going to be able to make a large network of friendships. And then I would say, concentrate on, does this person have the capacity to build a friendship? Yes. Yeah. I think one person is enough, personally. Yeah. But that may not be what is required for the order. And I think that's something the order needs to be talking about, actually.
Yes.
Are we going to say people should not be ordained if they cannot build a large network of friendship, or even a network of friendships?
Which is tantamount to say we can't ordain autistic people, I guess.
No, it's not quite true, because after all, I am ordained. And I have had great support from the people around me. But it was difficult, and it is still difficult. And I wish everybody could hear the conversations I've been having with people who've contacted me. Mitch was in the ordination process since we started doing these videos, talking about their isolation and loneliness and near despair about the fact that they cannot do this. And it's, and they do not see any way through the ordination process for them.
Yes.
And that is a very, very difficult place to be, and I resonate with it. I couldn't see any way through. And that was partly at the time because I didn't know I was autistic. I could not see any way through. In the end, I came to the conclusion this is never going to happen unless something comes in from outside to change the conditions. And in fact, something did for me come in from outside to change the conditions. I learned I was autistic.
Yes.
And then we could have a different sort of conversation.
Yes.
It's, you know, many autistic people have been in the ordination process for 20 years. 20 years? In the ordination process, never quite getting there. I don't see how that serves the Dharma. I don't see how that helps people.
Yes. Yes. And we talked in the first interview about the fact that once you told the order members who knew you, they changed their attitude towards you significantly, didn't they?
Yeah, and that was really supportive and really heartening. Finally, we all understood what was going on. Yes. So I know from my own experience that this is possible.
Yes.
But it does take both sides of the relationship to be actually sitting there saying, okay, we need to be able to explore this in a way that works for you. Yeah.
Yes.
And it's hard. It is hard because it may challenge people's ideas of what being an order member is about.
Yes.
And that's hard.
Yes. One of the things that I often say when I'm in a meeting about male midwives who ask for ordination, and the order comes together, the local order comes together, and we talk about somebody, their readiness. Very often someone will say, well, you know, their communication's or some other problem. And I say, but does that prevent them from going for refuge effectively? And very often that question is forgotten. It's more like, oh, there's something that's not quite right about that person and so on. But does it prevent them from going for refuge effectively, I often say. And when I ask that, they sort of go, oh, hmm. So that's the point, isn't it? What order members have to do with mitzvahs of ask for ordination is not worry or make too big of aspect thing of it to say, well, their communication's odd or something else about them. Are they effectively going for refuge? And that's what we've got to really look at, haven't we?
Yes. And that's, I mean, there are guidelines, but it's not very clearly defined, is it? The guidelines are open to interpretation,
yes.
Which is a good thing and which is also a difficult thing.
Mm.
Yes. It allows for individuality, but it also can sometimes make it difficult for people.
Yes. And I suppose what the order members who knew you did was they stopped thinking about a one-size-fits-all kind of model to, oh, well, in that case, we'll have to ask the question again, are you effectively going for refuge? And we won't ask you for some of the other things because you really can't do them.
I guess that's what they did.
Mm.
I mean, obviously, I wasn't part of that cooler in that sense, if you see what I mean. So, but I guess that's what had happened.
Yes.
And that is what I hope will happen in the coolers of people who have been perhaps in the ordination process a very long time, stuck at this bit.
Yes.
What does friendship actually look like?
Mm.
What does effective relationship actually mean?
Yeah.
Yes.
Ask me.
Yeah. It looks different, doesn't it, for everybody?
It does. It does, yes.
One size doesn't fit all with friendship.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Here's another question that just popped into my mind, and you may not know the answer to it, but are autistic people loyal?
Yes, usually. Mm. It's one of our strengths, and particularly in friendship, because it has been so difficult for us to get to that point that actually it would take a lot for us to walk away from a friend.
Mm.
Yeah, I mean, friendship is so important. It's a basic human need, isn't it? And we have that need too. Yes.
Yes.
So we also tend not to be deceptive.
Oh.
And again, that's a generalization, but generally we tend not to be deceptive. Mm. We say what we think.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
This is really good, actually. And what I'd like to do on another occasion is stop talking about the problems of being autistic within the movement and talk about the strengths.
Yes.
Yeah. So loyal and not deceptive. They're really good qualities, aren't they, for friendship?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. And for me personally, it's such a joyful thing to have friends. I didn't for most of my life, you know, and although you can live like that, it isn't the same as living with friendships.
I remember you talking about that in the first interview, and I said, were you unhappy about, you know, not having friends, how did it affect you? And said, no, because you don't miss what you've never had. But I just want to go into that again with you, because now you're saying that you'd lived for so many years without friendship, and now you've got friendship, and you see how beneficial it is and how joyful and so on. In retrospect, does it make you sad about the life you had before you had friends?
I think what I'm sad about is that I didn't know I was autistic when I was a child.
Mm.
And I think if I had known that and the people around me had known that, my life would have been very different.
Yes.
And I think that missed opportunity, actually, is what makes me sad.
Mm.
I am not, in a sense, sad about not having friends because I did the best I could. And that, in the end, is all we can do. But I can see that life is a lot richer with friends.
Yes.
And I would be very, very lonely now if I did not have friends.
Ooh.
Gosh. I'm just leaving a gap there because it's a very strong thing that you just said. But back to the questions. You suggested to me that we talk about this issue in this interview. Is there anything else you want to say about the sixth guideline, for instance, and autism?
I think there are patterns within the ordination process that I'm beginning to see, which is that neurodiverse people particularly find this sixth requirement of the eight guidelines the one that stops them for a long time. And I would just ask, really, for people to be aware that this can look different to different people. Friendship looks different. There's a bit in the sixth guideline that says, in which Sangha activities do I participate? For example, festivals.
No.
An autistic person, a neurodiverse person, may well not be at a festival.
Yes.
Does that mean they're not effectively going for refuge?
Mm.
That's the question, isn't it?
Yes.
Does that mean that they're not doing what is expected of people who are showing that they're effectively going for refuge?
Yes.
That's a different question.
Yes. I think it might be useful for whoever put these six guidelines together, or whoever's responsible for it now anyway, if they spoke to an autistic person and sort of had a sixth guideline which is different for autistic people or neurodiverse people even to neurotypical people.
I think it would be helpful. And I would very strongly say that should be for neurodiverse people, not autistic people.
Yes.
Because neurodiverse people have the same difficulties with communication in many ways that autistic people do. We are all, after all, neurodiverse. It can show itself a little difficulty, but it's one of the big things for a great many neurodiverse people. I remember that 1 in 7 people are probably neurodiverse.
Yes.
It may be even as many as 1 in 5. Something I read recently suggested it was now 1 in 5 that they think is neurodiverse. So this is a lot of people who are going to struggle with this.
Yes.
And yet it is important. As I said, the capacity for friendship, the capacity for being a friend is important for an order member. And I'm not saying we should get rid of it or anything. I'm just saying that we need to look at it.
Yeah.
If this is what is holding people back from being ordained, is there a way that we can help people get through this?
Yes.
Because I think the order itself is a wonderful thing. I'm passionately keen on people being able to join the order. I think it's great. Yes. I know how much I have got out of it. Now I am an order member, and I would like other people to have those opportunities. But at the moment, some of them are getting stuck.
Again, someone I know who's autistic, she says that she's come to the conclusion that she wants to join the order, but if it means doing all these things, I won't or I can't do that.
Yeah, I think that's a bit sad because I don't think the order is only about this. Surely it's about deepening our going for refuge.
Yes.
Surely it's about serving the Dharma.
Yes.
It's not just about friendship, although friendship is really important.
And friendship can take different forms, can't it?
Yes.
Like one way perhaps someone would adjust this sixth guideline for neurodiverse people is talk more about deep one-to-one, maybe two people in your life, deep friendships with order members. Because, you know, the deeper a friendship is, the better. So if you can forge two very deep friendships with a couple of people, surely that's going to be really good for you and it's going to help you effectively go for refuge.
I think that should be enough. That's my personal opinion. I think if somebody can do that with two people, then they can do it.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. It may never be possible for them to do it with a lot of people.
Yeah. I suppose the difficult thing is that in order to know whether someone's effectively going for refuge, it has to be more than two people who think that.
Yes.
There has to be a consensus of order members around who know you a little bit and so on. So that's a difficult issue, and I can't see how you can get over that.
I struggle with that one myself, because we are asking, is somebody ready to join an order, and an order is the reorder is relationships. So if the people around you genuinely don't know you, then I think it's very difficult for them to comment on whether or not you're actually ready and effectively going for refuge.
I suppose what could happen is the two people, let's say it's two people that you know very well, in the order, they would say what they think and other people would trust them.
That, I think, would be ideal. And I think for that to work, the two people would have to be well embedded in the order. Let's put it that way.
Yes.
So, again, I think it could work if people were prepared to accept that.
Yes.
Yeah.
There's another aspect to the ordination process. For women, anyway, I'm not sure it happens so much for men, is the cooler idea of a bunch of order members who know the person who wants to get ordained. They know them a little bit anyway. And maybe five of them meet with that person over a period of time. And then that is also a kind of preparation for chapters, isn't it? Now, you're in a chapter.
Yes.
How's that for you, being in a chapter?
The people are lovely. The actual institution of chapter I find very, very tiring. Having to relate to a group of people all the time. I come out exhausted. I just come out exhausted. That's why I have to be in the daytime chapter. I can't actually do it in an evening chapter. And yet, as I say, I want to start by saying the people are lovely. Yes.
Yeah.
It's just that if there is a conversation going on and I am trying to keep up with the conversation, that is tiring. Yeah. There is so much involved in conversation that is not verbal, particularly if it's a group of people. And not reading non-verbal communication is one of the typical problems of being neurodiverse. So if I'm having a conversation with somebody, I hear their words, and then I have to put it in context. And then I have to look at their facial expression and think, now, what is that facial expression? And then I have to look at my file of facial expressions to think, what might that facial expression be? And then I have to think, well, with this person, that might potentially be X, Y, Z. Yes. And then I have to think, okay, so what is an appropriate response to that? Yeah. Sometimes I even get it right. Yes. You know? But sometimes I don't. And that, there's so much going on in every single interaction that it is extremely tiring. I come out of chapter and I have to go away by myself for a while.
Yes.
And actually just recover.
Yes.
Because it's tiring. It really is tiring.
So is there anything else you want to talk about with Triratna, autism, the ordination process, becoming Mitra?
I think that being an order member has so much to offer to so many people. I think it is sad that people are not getting through this because of difficulties in one area. And I want to say that, and I think, I hope people can hear what I'm saying here. I think this is sad. Yes. And I feel that very strongly. And I think that we can look at this and perhaps change the way we look at this as an order to make it more inclusive for more people. I would like more people to have the benefits of being in the order.
And I think we'll leave it at that point.
Yeah.
Prajnanandi,
that was
a wonderful conversation, very moving as well. Thank you.
Thank you. And that was probably the most difficult conversation I've had so far in this. In this series. That's very close to my heart and it's very difficult to talk about, actually.
Yes.
So thank you for helping me do that.
Well, thank you for opening up so much. It's been a pleasure and a privilege.
Thank you.
Thank you.